In the late 90s, Crash Bandicoot was a PlayStation sensation. Having first debuted in 1996, Crash quickly took the world by storm, becoming Sony's unofficial mascot for the PS1 and managing to go head-to-head with video game juggernauts Mario and Sonic the Hedgehog. But for developer Naughty Dog, its time with the orange marsupial was rather short-lived. As work on Crash Bandicoot Warped neared completion, the team was given the opportunity to create one more Crash title. But rather than make a fourth entry in their popular platforming series, they decided to make a kart racing game instead. While Crash's kart racing legacy pales in comparison to Mario Kart, having only received a handful of follow-ups, with questionable levels of quality, the original game is still fondly remembered to this day, and represents a brief time in history when an American video game developer was able to directly challenge one of Nintendo's flagship franchises. This is the origin of Crash Team Racing. Crash Team Racing started life in mid-1998, while Crash 3 was still in production. At the time, the game was known internally as Project X, and Crash was nowhere to be seen. Instead, the game featured blockheaded characters with no personality to speak of. Prior to this, the team had discussed in meetings what their next game, after Crash 3, should be, and decided that they didn't want to work on a fourth platform game, as they felt they'd already exhausted all of their good ideas. The development cycle for Crash 3 had also seriously drained the team, so the idea of making another one wasn't very appealing. They were itching to do something new, and it just so happened that their technology was reaching a point where they felt confident doing something in 3D that didn't require a camera to be locked in place with a pre-calculated number of polygons. The team also happened to be big fans of kart races, like Mario Kart, and were extremely into multiplayer games, so the idea of bringing something similar over to the PlayStation seemed like a no-brainer. Over the course of developing three Crash games, the team had accumulated a diverse range of 3D art assets, characters, and locations that they could base their tracks on. So it only made sense to make Project X a part of the Crash universe. There was just one problem. They didn't own the rights, as the Crash IP was the property of Universal Interactive Studios. Naughty Dog had previously signed a three-project publishing deal with Universal, which is what led to the creation of Crash 1, 2, and 3. But they weren't keen on continuing their relationship with them, as their partnership was rather tenuous. Originally, as part of the deal they signed, Universal would provide Naughty Dog with a budget and office space, as well as market and distribute their games. But when Sony became enamored with Crash, they eventually negotiated to publish the games themselves. This left Universal having to figure out how they were going to get paid. Their solution was to simply take a cut of Naughty Dog's profits. Unfortunately for Naughty Dog, their contract never accounted for this, so they had no way of fighting it. This new arrangement meant Universal had no more marketing costs, had very little internal management costs, and eventually, they even managed to push the financing costs back to Sony. Universal's one and only contribution was Mark Cerny, who was a Universal employee and their producer. His involvement with the Crash series was indispensable, but by the time work had started on CDR, he wasn't even working for Universal anymore, and was being contracted by Naughty Dog directly, meaning Sony was effectively paying for his work, and not Universal. From that point on, they did next to nothing except collect royalties. So after fulfilling their contractual obligation, Naughty Dog decided to approach Sony directly. At this point in time, CTR was nothing more than a prototype. The team prioritized getting their new engine up and running, while the bulk of Naughty Dog's staff wrapped up development of Crash 3. Even during this early prototyping phase, CTR proved to be fun. They built an entire replica of Crescent Island from Diddy Kong Racing to see if they could reproduce a track of that scope and scale on the PlayStation. They were able to demonstrate that they could actually build an environment like this and fit it into memory whilst maintaining a playable framerate. The team took what they had to Sony and offered to make the game based on Crash characters so long as they negotiated with Universal for the rights on their behalf. In the worst case scenario, Sony wouldn't be able to get the rights, and they'd have to come up with original characters. Fortunately, for all parties involved, Sony was able to obtain the rights, and CTR became a reality. Following up three critically and commercially successful platformers with a racing game was a bold move for Naughty Dog, and there was some initial concern from a few members of the team, but the vast majority were overwhelmingly enthusiastic about working on the game. Not only was it a nice change of pace, it also gave them the opportunity to further develop technologies that the studio had tinkered with in the vehicle sections of Crash 3. In late 1998, after applying the finishing touches to Crash 3, the team took a well-earned rest in order to recover. Well, almost all of them. While it had become tradition to take a month off after shipping their holiday release, so that they could come back fresh in the new year to start work on their next project, CTR was being built in a brand new engine, so some of the team needed to stay behind in order to get it finished. Come January 1999, after most of the team had returned from their vacation, CTR shifted into full-scale production. Developing CTR alongside Crash 3 turned out to be the right call, as the small technical design team that had built the game's engine were able to get a lot of things done before the bulk of the art staff was brought on board, which helped to streamline the game's production. This was a blessing in disguise, as Naughty Dog had just hired a new group of programmers and designers who ended up working on the game, while the core team behind Crash 3 moved on to Jak and Daxter for the PS2. A new group of people making a game together isn't exactly ideal, and the short 8-month and 6-day production cycle didn't help matters, but by getting the engine done ahead of time, they were able to avoid potential bottlenecks. For Naughty Dog co-founder Andy Gavin, CTR stands out as the only game released during his tenure where he wasn't the lead programmer. The game also marks an important footnote in co-founder Jason Rubin's career as well, as it was the first game he directed without help from Andy. To help prepare for doing the game, the team took cues from other games in the kart racing genre, most notably Mario Kart. They brought in gamers and watched them play Super Mario Kart and Mario Kart 64 to get some insight. What they learned was that there wasn't much button action. People just held down accelerate and pushed left and right to turn. To address this in CTR, they built the game's vehicles to be far more maneuverable. They knew that the carts needed to be responsive, because if it didn't feel like you were in control, you blamed the game and not yourself. It was such an important thing to get right that they spent numerous hours tuning and refining it throughout development. By giving the player very tight control over their vehicle, they can make the mechanics of CTR more demanding, without being more frustrating. While the game's overall feel took inspiration from Super Mario Kart, for Evan Wells, it was Mario Kart 64 that really got his creative juices flowing. When the game released in North America in early 1997, he was still working at Crystal Dynamics on Gex 2. He really wanted to make a racing game that took on Mario Kart 64, and luckily for him, Naughty Dog was already one step ahead. He was recruited with his good friend Daniel Chan to come work for Naughty Dog, and was delighted to be working on CTR. During the early days of the game's development, the team would play countless hours of Mario Kart 64, analysing the track designs, the feel of the controls, how the AI worked, everything. The PlayStation had very different rendering capabilities compared to the N64, so they had to come up with all sorts of tricks to build tracks of a similar scale, while maintaining the high-quality graphics that the Crash Bandicoot games were known for. They also worked on making the AI in CTR more sophisticated than the track-following carts in Mario Kart and Diddy Kong Racing. They wanted the carts to not only move realistically, but also fire on the player and each other, in order to replicate the feeling that you were playing against real people. To ensure CTR would be fun for players of all skill levels, they implemented a form of adaptive difficulty to dynamically scale the game's challenge depending on who was playing. If the player was lagging behind, for instance, the racers in front would start shooting at each other to cause more of them to crash and give the player a chance to catch up. They wanted the difference between winning and losing to come down to just a few seconds, so that players would never feel too secure about their lead. This rubber banding effect, despite being a somewhat controversial thing in the games industry, ensured that players of all skill levels could have fun. Playtesting also played a crucial role. Not only did the team playtest it themselves, sometimes going on for hours because they were having so much fun with it, they also did testing on-site at Sony. They would videotape players, have them fill out questionnaires, and also watch them behind glass, all for the sake of making CTR a better product. Naughty Dog's biggest headache when developing CTR was trying to overcome the technical limitations of the PlayStation. They were at their peak of their understanding of the console, and yet, even with all that expertise, they barely managed to get CTR running on it. The smooth, open 3D environments were incredibly taxing on the PlayStation, and it pushed the console to its absolute limits. Part of the challenge of building CTR was trying to figure out how they were going to make the game fit within the constraints of the PS1's hardware, a challenge they almost couldn't overcome. Their previous Crash titles had fixed cameras that travelled down a set path. Because of this fixed perspective, they were able to use silicon graphics machines to reduce the number of draw calls of polygons that weren't needed. This not only meant that they had a perfect amount of polygons for any given frame, but it also allowed for texture to be streamed in as the level progressed. CTR's camera, on the other hand, was free to follow a cart wherever it went, so they couldn't stream data as effectively, and most things for a given track had to be in memory at all times. This made CTR an enormous resource hog, so the team needed to implement a variety of complicated real-time engine hacks to get the game running smoothly. For example, one memory-saving technique they implemented was a sophisticated culling routine to prevent the engine from rendering polygons the player couldn't actually see, like the backs of objects. To deal with the challenge of possibly having up to 64 kart tires on a 4-player split screen, Greg Omi developed an efficient way of rendering them as camera-based sprites. They also rendered the opponent carts to buffers, meaning not every character was drawn each frame, because they had to show 8 carts, and not just a single character. Their engine also solved a number of PlayStation limitations. For example, it was fairly common for PS1 game textures to warp, because the console didn't have any perspective correction. This was especially noticeable whenever big polygons were being used. To solve this problem, Daniel Chan and Greg Omi subdivided the polygons that were close to the camera into smaller polygons in order to minimize the effect. They'd essentially created subdivision surfaces before they had even been invented. Another innovation came with the way they handled textures. They developed a method of creating a single large texture by using lots of smaller ones. For example, the sand on the beaches were made up of 32 by 32 pixel textures for all the grains of sand, starfishes, clamshells, etc. that all formed a larger 128 or 256 pixel texture. This had the benefit of both looking great and also being seen as tiny to the PlayStation's texture memory. Another engine trick they pulled was with the game's frame rate. While the game targeted 30 frames per second, they actually had the frame rate unlocked. While the game would never go above 30 FPS, they allowed the engine to run at any frame rate it could go at. It may not sound all that impressive nowadays, but for the time, it was a novel idea. One of CTR's most distinguishable features is its turbo system, which was one of the first mechanics to emerge from the team's early prototyping. Having already noticed the slam the gas button and steer mechanics of other kart races, Naughty Dog set out to create a way for the player to be more involved. They designed their turbo system to enable players to get boosts of speed, both from hang time and during power slides. The latter being credited to Dan Array, and was inspired by the power drift mechanics in Japanese racing, while the former added an element of vertical gameplay that hadn't really been seen in the racing genre before. To pull off these boosts, the player needed to manipulate more buttons, and be more aware of their driving, which made it feel far more interactive than other kart races on the market. In addition to hang time boosts and power slides, there was also a starting boost that could be activated at the beginning of a race, if timed correctly, turbo pads that were scattered across a track that you could drive over, and turbo power-ups. By using a combination of these different types of turbo, it was possible on some tracks to be at an almost constant boost for an entire lap. When it came time to design the game's power-ups, the team tried to create an even mix of both offensive and defensive weapons, and threw out whatever tipped the balance. It was a difficult juggling act, because some players were naturally skilled, so when they added power-ups like the tracking missile, they had to be careful not to tip the scale. They played around with the probability of what came out of the crates, in order to strike the perfect balance. There were also a few power-ups that ended up being cut entirely, such as fake crates that would have presumably worked similarly to Mario Kart 64's fake item boxes. These ended up being cut pretty quickly, because they seemed cheap. Another power-up that was cut was a spring that would allow your kart to perform a high jump. Just like the feather in Super Mario Kart, it wasn't a very fun power-up to use. Anytime a person got it, they just used it immediately so that they could get a more useful power-up, so it ended up being removed from the final game. When deciding CTR's races, the team had a wealth of characters to choose from. They went through all of the characters in the Crash universe and tried to pick an appropriate mix of good and evil. Numerous assets from Crash 1 were recycled for CTR, Papu Papu being one such example. Due to the memory limitations of the PS1, they weren't able to do the lip sync on his entire body, so they chopped off his head and put his body on a generic loop, so that only the head needed to be animated. They were also originally going to have Pura and Pola ride together in the same cart, but due to memory limitations, they couldn't get it to work. Both Komodo Mo and Joe were planned to be playable, but Komodo Mo ended up being left on the sidelines, because the team ran out of time to properly implement him. Penta Penguin was a secret unlockable character, and the only racer with all of his stats maxed out. Except in the US, where he was a light character similar to Pura and Polar. In the first print of the game, Gavin James can be heard saying
"Penguin Yay 1, Penguin Yay 2,
in a monotone voice. These were originally recorded as placeholders, but they somehow slipped past the QA team and ended up in the final product. When Rob Titus took a copy of the game home, the day the game went gold, he noticed the bug and immediately called Daniel Chan, but it was too late to change it. Subsequent releases had this bug fixed. The game's antagonist, Nitrous Oxide, came together through a collaborative effort. The idea of making him an alien first clicked when the team was building Oxide Station. Jason had the idea of giving him four legs. Their Japanese producers had the idea of a racer helmet-like design, and several of their American producers came up with the idea of dreads coming out the sides of his head. When CTR released, rumors persisted about a way of unlocking Nitrous Oxide as a playable character. While the team had considered making him playable at one point, they were under such extreme memory limitations that they just couldn't get him to work across the entire game. They even had to design his boss level specifically with his larger character model in mind. Bob Raffi, who was responsible for making the level, spent a lot of time cutting it down to fit it into memory, as the level was originally 3 times longer than the final version. By using a GameShark cheat device, it's possible to get Nitrous Oxide in the game, but you aren't able to play as him on every track, and even on ones you can, the game will frequently crash. The team was well aware of GameShark cheat devices, as they were kind of a big thing back then, but what's most surprising is that according to Evan Wells, they actually used one themselves in the office, because it allowed them to install a thing called EasyRay, which was Yazaray, spelt backwards. Net Yazaray was a special development kit that Sony gave out to fans so that they could make their own homebrew-style PS1 games. They used EasyRay in the office because it would give them better data dumps whenever the game crashed. The game's story originally had Nitrous Oxide as a mad scientist, obsessed with speed. So much so that he concocts an elaborate scheme to speed up Crash's world by using his hyperactivator, a diabolical device that he built to speed up the entire planet. When switched into overdrive, minutes become seconds and days become hours. Being an ultra-fast freak of nature, this will finally allow Nitrous Oxide to be comfortable with the world at this new speed. The rest of the world's citizens, however, will be lost in an endless mind-wrenching blur as everything zooms past them in the blink of an eye. Crash, his friends, and his lifetime enemies must work together in one united attempt to defeat Nitrous Oxide once and for all. By challenging each other in a series of races, one of them might just be good enough to face him in a final showdown. In the finished game, Nitrous Oxide challenges Crash's world to a racing contest he calls Survival of the Fastest. Should the inhabitants win, the planet will be spared, but should he win, then the entire planet will be turned into a concrete parking lot. To accompany the story, the team included a Diddy Kong Racing-inspired adventure mode, where players win trophies and boss keys in order to progress. It was a lot of extra work, but they felt compelled to tell some kind of a story, as it seemed a waste not to use these great characters and this rich world that they had created. It also allowed players to have some sense of progression and continued play. CTR's racetracks took inspiration from all of the interesting locations across the different levels in previous Crash games. They knew they were going to do a lot of island-themed stuff, but also wanted to experiment with some new themes. They also enhanced each track with set pieces to complement its theme, such as the halfpipe in Sewer Speedway. When building that track, Rob Titus put drivable collision all the way around the pipes to see if you could drive on top of them. To the surprise of both him and Gavin James, who did the game's physics, it actually worked. It did cause the camera to freak out, but once they got it sorted, it worked great. It felt almost like skateboarding. For the track Cortex Castle, they built it so that all of the turns were 90 degree angles, so that you'd have to navigate it very quickly and sharply. Tiger Temple, which had the working title Temple Ruins, was the first track Rob made, but it wasn't going too well, and he absolutely hated it. After abandoning it for a few months, he reluctantly came back to finish it, and it ended up turning out great. The twisting in the tunnel worked well, and he was pleased with the lighting. In the end, while he initially hated working on it, it ended up becoming his favourite track in the whole game. As well as themes, CTR's tracks also needed structure and features. They approached each track the same way they might approach a platformer level. There were main pathways to follow, but also secrets to uncover. So when it came time to make a new track, they'd sit down and lay out stuff on paper, Then they'd bring in artists, who'd add their own ideas, and they'd all work together, in small groups for each track. The game's engine also made track creation reasonably straightforward. Once they had built a track, they could knock them out pretty quickly, spending an average of 3 weeks per track. As they neared their deadline, certain features had to be cut in order to keep the game on schedule. Originally, they had the idea of players earning gold wrenches to upgrade their cart's performance, such as its acceleration, handling, and top speed. By completing races and defeating bosses in the game's adventure mode, you'd be awarded with these wrenches, which you could then use to buy different engine, exhaust, and tire upgrades for your cart. There would have been around 30 wrenches in the entire game. You could then save your upgraded cart to your memory card and use it in multiplayer matches. However, they soon realized that doing so would break the game's balance. After all, it'd be no fun to go against someone who had a top-end car if you didn't. Worse still, if the player chose the wrong upgrades in adventure mode, it might have made it impossible to win new races. While they could have eventually solved these problems, the team simply didn't have the time to test all of the possible combinations to make sure it was both balanced and winnable, so they ended up scrapping the idea entirely. An iced-themed track created by Rob Titus was also cut. It was a short 8-figure track that was all ice. He reused assets from the other snowy-themed tracks to create it, and he was pretty much finished with it when he showed it to Jason and Evan. Sadly, they didn't have enough time to properly debug it, so while it was certainly a fun track to play, it ended up being dropped. The reward for all of their hard work came in late 1999, when the game received glowing reviews from the press and a warm reception from players. But for all of the fun the game was, making it was extremely taxing. For Jason, it was the hardest game he'd ever directed, thanks in part to the short amount of time they had to develop it. While everything turned out great in the end, delivering a polished game on such a tight schedule with an entirely new engine was very stressful. So stressful, in fact, that several members of the team were burnt out by the end of its aggressive development cycle. Jason admits that they kept adding game modes late into CTR's development, which didn't help matters. While additional modes like the Battle Arena were a welcome addition, they took their toll on the team. As a consequence of this, CTR had more bugs to fix than most of their other titles. The game was plagued with a myriad of issues and would frequently crash, churning out nonsense results in data. It was sloppy compared to Naughty Dog standards, but nobody complained. They were also trying to ship the game to three territories and had decided to add Dutch to the game's languages, which complicated things further. They went from working with Universal to becoming an independent team, and then eventually becoming a first-party PlayStation studio. While this transition took several years, it started around the time when CTR was being developed. In total, roughly $2.4 million was spent developing the game. In 2019, a full remake of CTR was made by Canadian developer Beenox, with additional content from Crash Nitro Kart and Crash Tag Team Racing. The game received favorable reviews from critics, who praised the game's faithfulness to the original title, but it was also heavily criticized for its inclusion of microtransactions that was snuck in a month after the game's release. If you enjoyed this look back at the origin of Crash Team Racing, and would like to see more documentaries like this in the future, then be sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel. Also, if you have the means, consider throwing a dollar or two towards my Patreon, links in the description.